drums are going tonight. She hears only whispers of some quiet conversation. She's coming in 12:30 flight. The moonlit wings reflect the stars that guide me towards salvation. I stopped an old man along the way, hoping to find some old forgotten words or ancient melodies. He turned to me as if to say, hurry boy, it's waiting there for you.
Saludos amigos y bienvenidos a una nueva edición de Autos con Luis Mariano. Este es Luis Mariano Muñoz que nuevamente les presenta a ustedes lo mejor del automovilismo local e internacional. El programa de hoy les presentaremos una visita que hiciese nuestro colaborador en los Estados Unidos al Museo Simeone de Filadelfia. El Museo Simeone es la creación del propio Dr. Fred Simeone, un neurocirujano del área de Filadelfia retirado, que se ha dedicado a coleccionar, a ejercer esa pasión que tiene por los automóviles. Pero no solamente automóviles cualquiera, estamos hablando vehículos de competencia. Él ha plasmado en este museo la historia completa de lo que es las carreras de automóviles en los Estados Unidos y en Europa. Así que durante los próximos 60 minutos van a estar disfrutando de ustedes estos visuales que llegan gracias a los recursos y las gestiones de Tiva TV, el canal del automovilismo. Adelante, señor director.
Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, United States. Philadelphia is about 90 miles south of New York City. And this museum that you're going to see, our foundation museum, is near the airport in Philadelphia. Why don't you come inside and look at some interesting cars and learn about some automotive history.
I know that I must do what's right. Sure as Kilimanjaro rises like Olympus above the Serengeti.
Welcome to the Simeone Foundation Automobile Museum. The museum is about racing sports cars. Cars with fenders and lights, cars which were meant to be raced on the road. We really don't go into Indy cars or Formula One cars because we believe cars with this beautiful body as you see it, or one like this, are the most exciting to see. I've been asked to discuss how I came about collecting these cars, and it's an interesting story, really. It all relates to my father. My father was a physician, but he worked his way through medical school fixing cars. So when I was a young guy, we would go on house calls together, and afterwards we would go to junkyards and find cars. Luckily, this little bit of a head start allowed me to get some cars which I thought were historically important, a little bit ahead of the curve. So many of these cars were purchased in the 1970s and 1980s. During my regular working period, which was from about 1968 to about 2008, I was a neurosurgeon here in Philadelphia, but always had time to go look for the best cars, particularly the cars that fit that theme of the racing sports cars. Consequently, most of the cars you see in the museum actually participated in races like Le Mans, Sebring, the Mille Miglia, and the Targa Florio, which you see here now. And these cars have, in addition to their beauty and their performance, they all have a history which makes them even more exciting. Speaking of history, for instance, let's look at this car here. Alfa Romeo made this car originally as a racer, and it participated in the 1937 Mille Miglia, among other races, and in that race it came in second. The car then acquired this beautiful body and was sold. After World War II, it ended up in Argentina. I happened to be reading a 1950 Motorsport magazine and learned that this car was actually being raced at a place called Mar del Plata in Argentina, and all I knew was the driver's name. I was able to contact some friends in Buenos Aires, and they said, oh yeah, we know that name. They went to his place of business. He was really now retired. And in a ramshackle shed with a tin roof, corrugated tin roof with a lot of space in it, was this car basically covered with pigeon droppings. Well, you can imagine my excitement when we went over to Argentina and negotiated the purchase of the car. It's a Alfa Romeo 2900A, of which very few were built, and which in currently complete condition, only two exist. Tonight,
and she hears only whispers of some quiet conversation.
The Targa Florio exhibit here specializes in two cars. They are exactly 50 years apart. This car was made in 1925 and it participated in the Targa Florio race, we believe. The reason the Bugatti Type 35 is so important is because it won Targa Florio for the whole, basically, last half of the 1920s. Even though it was a French car and the Targa Florio was an Italian race conducted in Sicily, the Bugattis were dominant in that race. When we present this exhibit, we notice things for the observers, like the tires are narrow, the wheels are big, the headlights are out there blocking the wind as the radiator. It's not an aerodynamically sophisticated car, but yet for its time it was wonderful at demonstrating speed, reliability, and the Targa Florio, being a very difficult race, particularly through the streets of Sicily, was a real test of the car. Now, if we flash forward 50 years to 1975, we have another Targa Florio car. This is an Alfa Romeo 33 TT12. This car also raced in the Targa Florio, and it was one of the last races, and I think you can see why. The roads of Sicily just couldn't handle a car which was so aerodynamically beautiful, powerful, and just basically not meant for the road anymore. This was meant for track racing. But look at this in comparison to the Bugatti we saw just 50 years earlier. Here the headlights are enclosed so that they don't block the light. The wheels, as you can see, are small, but the tires are fat. So you have a greater traction, but a smaller wheel. The whole body is aerodynamically smoothed out. So besides incredible power, you're getting now almost 500 horsepower from a 12-cylinder engine, compared to a tenth of that, practically, from the smaller engine. You actually have a wonderful description of the effect of the desire to win, the effect of the need for speed in the car design in a period of just 50 years. Demonstration of a rifornimento, which is a refueling station such as the type they had in Italy during the time of the Mille Miglia. We have refueling of gasoline and refueling of wine for the drivers on the race. Really, the refueling station was a representation of a kind of an excuse for us to put this wonderful car in the exhibit. Not exactly a race car, although they did race it at Mille Miglia. It's called the Lancia Lambda. The Lambda is filled with absolutely novel features, which started around 1922, although this is a 1924 car. They were the first produced car with independent front suspension. You can see here how this wheel will travel up and down, independent of the rest of the car, through this piston-like effect. This was the first car where if your right tire hit a bump, the whole car wouldn't necessarily move, only the tire itself. When you have a solid axle, which was the absolute standard for cars for a decade after this, the whole axle moved, of course the car moved as well. Independent suspension. The second thing about this car, which is not readily available, is the body was produced at the same time as the chassis. So that you can see here, this body and the underlying chassis were one piece. Then when that was stamped out, you added the hood, you added the doors, and you added the gas tank and the things in the rear. This is called unibody construction. Absolutely, totally novel for the early 20s when it was done. in Italy, but now routine. By the mid-1930s, that was the only way they made cars, which is with an independent body construction, that is production cars. So Lancia Lambda is a name to remember. It's a wonderful car. The condition of this car represents what we like to see in cars. Now, some people may laugh because at the rest of the exhibit, you'll see some finely restored cars. This car apparently was never painted. It was never taken apart. It was just well cared for. In fact, it was in a garage in Hollywood since the late 1940s. So we knew that it was well preserved. If the car is well preserved, even though it isn't shiny and pretty, if it's well preserved with its original features, we like to keep the cars that way. And anyone who visits this museum will see several cars in their original preserved condition.
Bueno, espero estén disfrutando de este programa especial del Museo Simeone de Filadelfia y aprendiendo, al igual que este servidor de ustedes, sobre los autos históricos de competencia, como el Bugatti tipo 25, como el Alfa Romeo especial, que participaron en controversiales eventos de carretera en Italia, como lo fue la Targa Florio. También tuvimos la oportunidad de conocer cómo el doctor Simeone poco a poco comenzó esta colección que hoy en día se funde y se plasma en el Museo Simeone de Filadelfia. Bueno, pues ahora vienen tremendos automóviles, ya que vamos a estar hablando de las competencias de Sebring y los autos que fueron campeones en la época de los 50 y los 60. Así que van a ver preciosos Jaguares, van a ver De La Haye, van a ver Maserati, van a ver en sí una serie de vehículos de primera. Así que, sin ningún otro preámbulo, vamos directo al reportaje del museo.
This exhibit represents Sebring in America. Sebring is important because after the war, after World War II that is, it was the first track where Americans actually invited competitors from overseas to come to our shores. Remarkably, for the whole basic history of the automobile hobby, or let's say racing sport, we were essentially not inviting people to come to America. There were races in Targa Florio, Mille Miglia, Le Mans, but as you'll see, we rarely participated. It wasn't until 1953 where the Sebring track was created on an old World War II airfield, and we started to say to competitors from all over, come to America. The Jaguar company, were very active in racing at that time, was particularly helpful. In fact, they helped support Sebring, and they sent cars to Sebring as well. Or private owners bought Sebring cars, Jaguars particularly, to race. This car is a C-type Jaguar, which came in third in the 1953 Sebring race. As you can see, it has beautiful lines, a very special car made specifically for racing purposes. The style is exciting, and many people prefer this early 1950s style to the later, more streamlined version. This particular car here entered the 1956 Sebring race and it came in third. The driver was Jack Ensley. Ensley, interestingly, won that same year in 1955. He won the great Indianapolis race in a different type of car. Unfortunately, Ensley was killed, but his wife has a beautiful biography called Along for the Ride. And in the biography, she talks about how he learned to drive his car because he raced Indianapolis cars. And she said, another driver named Juan Fangio came to teach her husband how to drive this car, which we thought was very exciting because it is clear from her reading and the way she wrote it that she was unaware of what an iconic figure Juan Fangio was in the history of sports car racing. To go along with the Jaguar story, we have the pre-war Jaguar race car, another iconic car called the SS100. These cars were most important for rallying. In rallying, you go from point to point across a variety of roads, and there are more tests of endurance and timing and accurate driving. Nothing was more successful than the SS100 Jaguar. Nothing was more successful than the SS100 Jaguar, and you can see that it won the Monte Carlo Rally in 1935. Beautiful, beautiful cars, gorgeous in every respect. Before World War I, Peugeot actually fielded some interesting race cars, and after World War I, they even came to America and raced a bit. They decided in 1937 and 1938 to send three cars, 3 and 37 and 3 and 38, to Le Mans. These cars were very special. They had all aluminum bodies, no doors. They had special racing configurations to the engine and front driving lights. And this is one of the three cars that raced at Le Mans in 1938. Some people think the design is beautiful. Some people think it's a little overdone. Very Art Deco with these doodads here on the side, as you might see in any kind of Art Deco demonstration anywhere. They were very cute cars. They were not extremely powerful, but they did win a index of performance, which is a calculation on how fast the car went over a period of time and how much it used energy-wise. It turned out to be an index of performance winner. For 1938 and actually going into the 1940s, we have this important car, which is called the Delahaye. Delahaye was a company that entered racing, that is sports car racing, very briefly, and in 1936 they made 14 race cars. This car was actually purchased by Pierre Louis Dreyfus, and it was raced for a while before the war. The war ended, and now in 1946 we were starting to have race again. Of course, Le Mans was going to be starting up soon, so the racers wanted to get a race car, but there were none being made because the war effort basically consumed the time and energies of the French manufacturers. So what they did, the subsequent owners of this car, a man named Chaboud and Potsy, put this body on the car. This was a new version of what a sports racing car should look like. The problem is that by 1946 to 48, when this body was made, there had been no new design concocted. There was no new paradigm. So as a result, this car has this kind of funny looking body, which is really not very well designed. You can see, again, something that appeals to us perhaps more than most people is the condition of this car. The car was never repainted. It was purchased from the family of the last owner, a driver, Fontainebleau, in France. It's got the original engine, virtually all the original features. It's just kind of, as they say, still in its own juices, with original upholstery and everything that makes it a real document of the time rather than a restored, super pretty piece. We love the condition of cars like this. And it drives very well. We've had to do very little mechanically to get it in shape. You can see it still has a steering wheel. The gauges are all just as they were originally. This little thing here is an electric gear shift made by a company called Total. This was important because you put this in the gear that you wanted, and it did not shift until you depressed the pedal. When you depressed the clutch pedal, it would shift, so you could shift whenever you wanted. The advantage for this in race cars, and I learned this from Rene Grossis, who examined this car for me, was that when your car is turning, you want to have both hands on the wheels. If you're making a turn at 80 miles an hour, the car wants to go straight, and you have to hold on to it. But you also may want to downshift. So what you do is, ahead of time, you put this in the gear you want, go into your turn with both hands on the wheel, you press the clutch, and the car will downshift, but you will still have control of the car because both hands are on the wheel. In contrast to having to shift in the middle of the turn, where you would have to take one hand off the wheel. So this Potal or electric gearbox is an important factor for race drivers in that period of time. The Peugeot that you saw previously also has an electric gearbox. After World War II, in other words, this Delahaye raced at Le Mans in 1950 and 1951. But after World War II, the designers started to make beautiful cars for racing, particularly at Le Mans. These are specific race cars that we're talking about here. Italy was the leader in the design, and this beautiful 1954 Ferrari 375mm is a perfect example. Not only are the lines gorgeous, but it had a powerful 4.5 liter engine with great driving speed, comfort, and of course a car similar to this won the 1954 Le Mans race. The mid-50s were really dominated by Jaguar with the cars that you saw, the C and the D-type Jaguar. But Ferrari did come in with one of these and absolutely blew the crowd away. A few of these cars went to Argentina where they were very popular, and of course a car like this in the Argentina racing circle was extremely effective as the 375mm and the 375 Plus. For 1956, we had to introduce which was the greatest of the Maserati series, the 300S Maserati. Sterling Moss is said to have reported that this was probably the most exciting of all the sports cars that he drove. Maserati was a company that was never heavily funded, but they had great desire for drivers, and they had an intense desire to win in racing, always being competitors to the nearby Ferrari factory. Of all their cars, if we measure success in racing, particularly international racing, the 300S has to be the best. It was made to compete all over the world and won many races, although it usually came in second to a Jaguar or a Ferrari in terms of overall point championship. But look at the beauty of this car. Wonderful design, fast car, huge brakes, very powerful 3-liter engine, and it has everything to make it the winner that it was.
I seek to cure what's deep inside, frightened of this thing that I've become.
Bueno, si disfrutaron de lo que han visto hasta ahora, prepárense porque ahora les tenemos un reportaje especial de un Ferrari Testarossa del 1958. Y luego daremos un viaje por las competencias internacionales donde el doctor Simeone nos relata cómo vehículos americanos participaron y se destacaron ganando prominentes eventos a nivel internacional. Adelante, señor director.
This is 1958 Ferrari Testarossa. They only made about 19 of these cars specifically for racing. This was actually the first car that they sold to a customer, so it came immediately to California where it raced successfully out there. But it also went to Sebring and did some racing around the world. These cars were iconic for several reasons. First of all, they were basically winners at Le Mans in 1958. 60 and 61. The design has been considered the most successful, if not advanced, of the post-World War II sports car racing cars, particularly cars of the 1950s, although some may argue about that. But they were wonderful cars to drive, and their history of victory is either with this body or with another type of body on the same chassis in 1960 and 61 proved them to be winners. From the point of view of our collection, someone asked me, tell the people about the car that was most difficult for you to own. Well, it was this one. The previous owner loved Dennis Bentley, and he wanted to trade a 6-liter speed 6 Bentley, an 8-liter Bentley, and a supercharged Bentley, all of the Dennis types, for this car. I didn't have a whole lot of money at the time, but I was able to find some cash. This all happened in 1970. And fortunately, the owner didn't care whether the bodies were original or not. At that point in time, and that is in 1970s, you could get fabric covered bodies from England in those various forms. I found the chassis, put the bodies on, then went to our restorer and said, make these cars look exactly like you want the owner of the Testarossa wants them to be. After 3 to 4 years of patiently waiting for this to happen, we finally effected the trade. And when I brought this car into our garage, it was one of the happiest days of my life. Since then, the car has not disappointed us. It's absolutely turnkey, fast, quick, powerful, and a wonderful car in every way. And of course, the look of the car, the external appearance, speaks for itself. Have an exhibit we call Americans at Le Mans. Why Americans at Le Mans? Well, if anything, the exhibit shows how uninvolved America was in the major international race. Fortunately, that changed later on, but we can't let an exhibit like this go by. That is an exhibit which relies heavily on the sports car history of Le Mans without the remarkable observation that America didn't participate. Actually, before Le Mans was a 24-hour race, Americans did send cars over one time, and that was with reference to the open-wheel race that was held at Le Mans, but not as a 24-hour race. This is a Duesenberg that was actually in that race, not a sports car, but I just want to show it to you briefly because they sent three cars over to race at Le Mans. One of them won, and that was 1921. And we did not send cars over very frequently after that. However, in 1928, the Stutz Company was interested in sports car racing through its president, Fred Moskowitz. And overseas, people recognized that the Stutz would be a great car for Le Mans, even though, in actual fact, the Americans weren't interested in Le Mans that much. So Stutz cars were bought by Frenchmen, race, and a car similar to this actually came in second in 1928 to a Bentley. The Bentley won, but Stutz made it, did a pretty good job. Recognizing that the next year, 1929, the French again wanted to participate, but they needed a stronger car to beat Bentley, they made a supercharged car. And we're going to see that later on, because that car is currently being prepared to be shown in the Pebble Beach Town Fair, which is coming up in a month or so. And that car will be right in the spot that you see here. Well, the Stutz Company did not send a winner because in 1929, the supercharged car that you'll see in a few minutes, the best they could do was come in fifth. However, there was one other American who was convinced that he could enter Le Mans. Remember, again, they're racing from Germany, Italy, France, England, in large numbers, no Americans. But E. Paul DuPont, who was a scion of the DuPont Manufacturing Company, at that time DuPont also owned Indian motorcycles and they were building cars, they decided we want to go at Le Mans. So they made a few of these Le Mans speedsters.
Bueno, la pasada media hora ha estado espectacular y apenas hemos cubierto la mitad de lo que es el primer programa del Museo Simeone de Filadelfia. Así que, ¿para qué hablar? Vamos directo al reportaje. Adelante con las cámaras y los visuales, señor director.
Of its time, whether it was made for racing or whether it was made for just touring. It's a wonderful touring car. Even though it was made in 1938, when you drive it, you feel like you're in a modern car because of the suspension, the well-worked-out gearbox, and the precise control that you have. So it's hard to have a reason not to make it your favorite car. It doesn't disappoint. Four or five of these were made for the Mille Miglia. Two of them exist now in the original form. Now, what did America do? Well, we mentioned that America did have cars in the 1950s by Briggs Cunningham. Actually, the cars really didn't do so well, so they don't belong in the winner's circle except for this particular car. They made three cars of the series. By they, I mean Briggs Cunningham himself. They were called Cunningham C4Rs. There were two roadsters like this and one coupe. This car actually won its class at Le Mans. The best we really did at Le Mans until 1966, when we won outright. Beautiful car in many ways. It has a big Chrysler Hemi engine in it, an interesting body design. People always ask about this. This is an oil cooler because the cars ran very hot and they had to have this cooling effect. It's brutally fast. I hesitate to even start it for you because the decibel level is overwhelming. But they were great cars. A car just like this, the other Roadster, won at Sebring against very strong British competition. And we should be very proud of it, not so much as Americans, but for Briggs Cunningham, who was a gentleman, a man who wanted to win in international racing. In fact, he was a sailing champion, having won the America's Cup in his boat. So here we have an American car finally doing something in the 1950s, although not actually being able to win the whole beautiful prize. But damn nice, and these cars were feared by their competitors. Really, maybe one of the prettiest cars in the collection. Certainly, its record is phenomenal when you consider that Aston Martin and its owner, David Brown, desperately wanted to win at Le Mans. They wanted to have the big prize. They were not a heavily funded organization, but they were able to make four of these cars called the DBR1, which were very, very highly advanced. First came out in 1958, and they were beautiful. They had torsion bar suspension, the disc brakes, just every possible conceivable feature to make them great, and the six-cylinder, three-liter engine. This actual car won the Nürburgring race in 1958 with Stirling Moss driving. It went on to be a great racer because after 1959, when Aston Martin did win the World Championship of Makes, with just four cars racing, beating Ferrari, beating everybody else, it was clearly the end of the line for David Brown, who could just not afford to continue racing. He sold the car to a Scottish group, the Border Reavers, and famous driver Jim Clark drove this at Le Mans in 1960 and 61. So a car with a great history, unquestionable beauty, and really a highlight of its era, with only four being made for racing. We're very proud to own this car. We drive it periodically on the back, and you can clearly demonstrate its superiority to most of the other 1950s cars in terms of its suspension, braking, transmission, and of course its power and speed. The interior is pretty basic. You see, because it has a transaxle, we have the transmission here with rods going to the rear. It has this, a spare oil sump so that these cars never run out of oil. You can see here the torsion bar suspension, which is adjustable. And that's very effective in keeping the rear where you want it to be. The dash is pretty standard. All of these cars emphasized a tachometer. That's all you needed for racing. You never had anything like a speedometer, which is any value, but you tried to keep the RPMs near this red line, which was adjustable, and this one is running about 6,200 RPM. Overall, very Spartan, very basic design, but this is all you needed for international racing. Thank you.
Bueno, aquí estamos en la recta final de este programa especial del Museo Simeone en Filadelfia y le hemos guardado lo mejor para esta última sección. Aquí verán el Ford GT del 1967, aquel histórico vehículo o grupo de vehículos que viajó de los Estados Unidos a participar en las 24 horas de Le Mans, terminando en la primera, segunda y tercera posición. También verán el Porsche 917, uno de los más rápidos e históricos Porsche de esta fabricante alemán, conocido como el Hippie Car por su pintura sumamente peculiar. Así que vamos a ver esta última sección aquí en Autos con Luis Mariano.
Next year, a company in America was charged with building an all-American-made car to compete at Le Mans, and here you have the beautiful Mark IV GT40, which is significantly different. You can see the external design is different. The car has a chassis made of honeycomb aluminum. In other words, two sheets of aluminum with epoxy holding a honeycomb framework, very, very light, but having the structural strength of steel, but a much lighter weight. Again, with the big 427 Ford engine in it, one of these came in first at the 1967 Le Mans, driven by Gurney and Foyt. So we had the first time an American-made car driven by Americans was a winner at Le Mans. The 1966 car was, of course, an American car, but it was not driven by Americans. This car is interesting because this was not the winner. It did have the speed record at that Le Mans, going 224 miles an hour. 224 miles an hour was pretty damn fast in those days. However, at the end of the straight, where you reach that top speed, you have to make a sharp turn. This car didn't turn fast enough, ended up in the sand, and of course it could not get back in the race because it ended up deep in the sand with Denny Hulme and Lloyd Ruby driving. Ultimately, it took them two or three days to get it out of the sand. It was given to the Hara Museum, and then we got it from the Hara collection. The nice thing about this car, from our point of view, it still has its original paint as it left the Ford factory. Barely understand. When Vic Elford was here, he said you just drove by real excitement. The other guy who drove this particular car was Willy Kalsen. Willy Kalsen was the test driver for Porsche. And when it was raining and it was pretty bad, they said you go out and drive it because the other drivers were afraid of this car. Although it was the fastest car Porsche made, and as I said, this particular car set a speed record, it was also the most difficult to handle. Willy Kalsen, being a test driver, was able to get it on the road. However, this picture driving 24 hours with pouring rain, the car slipping and sliding around, Willy told me in his, he's now, you know, much older, and he told me in his broken German, he says, as I was driving, we were spinning and we were turning, and then I saw the lights coming toward me, and I said, there must be something wrong. Obviously, he had done a 180, and he righted himself and brought the car in second. Vic Elford said that that it was a wonderful experience. This was the greatest period of his life, driving these cars. I asked him, how do you feel that the cars are now not being driven but they're being demonstrated, but not being driven at anger. You feel that's a waste. His attitude, as most of the race drivers who've been here, our museum's been visited by Mario Andretti, Brian Redman, of course, Vic, Janet Guthrie, and some others. And I think they all appreciate the fact that the cars, at least in a museum, get used occasionally, but they're here for people to see and contemplate, as you would at any other museum. They are historical objects, and they should be put in a diorama or a system where this wonderful history that goes back to the turn of the century can be revealed and reiterated. You can see, again, something that appeals to us perhaps more than most people is the condition of this car. The car was never repainted. It was purchased from the family of the last owner, the driver,
Qué triste cuando llega el momento de la despedida, particularmente luego de ver este tremendo programa sobre el Museo Simeone. Pero la verdad es que el tiempo corre más rápido que los mismos automóviles de competencia que les hemos mostrado hoy. Este programa, estos visuales han llegado a ustedes gracias a la colaboración de nuestro corresponsal en los Estados Unidos, el amigo Luis Fernández, que estos visuales los presenta en carácter exclusivo aquí para Autos con Luis Mariano y por supuesto a los esfuerzos y recursos de Tiva TV. Agradecemos también la colaboración del propio doctor Fred Simeone, que se tomó el tiempo de acompañarnos para presentarle a ustedes el personalmente vehículo por vehículo. Ahora solo realmente me queda recordarles a ustedes que pueden seguir todo lo que ven aquí en este programa de Autos con Luis Mariano en las páginas cibernéticas de autosclásicosehistóricos.com. Ahí podrán buscar los reportajes a fondo de cada uno de nuestros programas y recuerden que pronto les estaremos presentando nuestro nuevo portal de Autos con Luis Mariano TV, donde podrán también accesar a los programas y verlos a su propia comodidad. Ahora realmente solo queda despedirme de ustedes, invitarlos a que nuevamente, semana tras semana, sintonicen aquí Tiva TV para este programa de Autos con Luis Mariano y continúen ayudándonos a dispersar, a propagar la palabra del canal del automovilismo en Puerto Rico. Que Dios lo bendiga a todos y que tengan una maravillosa semana.